Hello and welcome to Module 4 of the NIH Principles of Clinical Pharmacy course. My name is Bruce Waldrop. I'm an Associate Professor of Pharmacology at the McWhorter School of Pharmacy at Stanford University. So Module 4 is going to be looking at the pharmacokinetics and drug therapy in special populations. The purpose of this lecture is just to give you a brief overview of the different topics that we will be covering in Module 4 and orient you to some of the terminology and concepts that we will be covering later on. Now, special populations refers to patient populations which have important differences in pharmacokinetics or pharmacodynamic responses compared to the general population. We'll be looking at six of those special populations in this module, which are shown here. And again, over the next few minutes, we're just going to hit some major points for each of these six areas, just so that you're ready and prepared to go into more detail later. The first we will look at is renal replacement therapy. Now, there's various types of renal replacement therapy. Two of these are shown here, but the main function of renal replacement therapy is to replace the non-endocrine functions of the kidney, basically to serve as a filter to remove waste products, solutes, and so on. Now, sometimes that also includes drug, and we'll get to that in just a second. On the left, we have continuous veno-venous hemofiltration. In this process, we take the patient's blood, pass it through a filter using pressure, and by convective flow, solute is removed and then the blood is returned to the patient. On the right, we have essentially the same process, but this time we add dialysis. So in addition to the convective flow, we also have diffusion of solute. So a little bit different, but the same principles apply. Now, when we look at drug removal and renal replacement therapy, there's a few things we have to consider. First, what are the properties of the filter? Is it a high permeability filter? Does it have a large pore size, or is it low permeability? What's the surface area of the filter, and what's the thickness of the filter? Additionally, let's look at the properties of the drug. Is this a high molecular weight drug? Is it too large to pass through the pores of the filter, or is it low molecular weight? Is the drug hydrophilic or is it lipophilic? Drugs with very large VDs that extensively bind to tissue will have very little of the drug in the plasma, so those drugs would not be very effectively removed by renal replacement therapy. Also, if the drug has a high degree of protein binding, it's not going to be able to pass through the filter. So drugs that have very low fraction unbound, those drugs would not be good candidates for removal by renal replacement therapy. And finally, the transmembrane pressure gradient as well as the dialysis flow rate can dictate how well solute and therefore drug can be removed by these processes. We'll also be spending a lot of time on hepatic drug metabolism and factors that affect hepatic drug metabolism. So as you know, the liver serves very important role in physiology, including drug metabolism and elimination. Some other things that are listed there include carbohydrate, fat, and cholesterol metabolism, the synthesis of protein, importantly plasma proteins that drugs bind to, such as plasma albumin. Clotting factors are also synthesized in the liver. And the liver serves as a storage site for fat-soluble vitamins as well as glycogen and other substances. Now, when we look at drug clearance by the liver, we have to consider how much blood flow is going to the liver and what is the extraction ratio of that particular drug in the liver. So the clearance is determined by hepatic blood flow, or Q, times the extraction ratio. We'll get more into detail on the next slide on that. Now, there's two main types of metabolism that occur in the liver. Phase 1 metabolism involves CYP450 mediated metabolism, such as hydroxylation or dealkylation reactions. Phase 2 metabolism involves conjugation reactions such as glucuronidation or sulfation. Phase 2 involves the addition of a usually polar molecule to the drug molecule to make it more water soluble. Phase 1 and phase 2 may occur independently or sequentially through the liver. Now, going back to extraction ratio, we can have a high E drug, which has an extraction ratio of 70% or higher, or a low E drug, which is 30% or lower. So high E drugs, the only thing that limits the ability of the liver to clear those drugs is how much blood flow you are sending to the liver. So those would be flow limited drugs. On the other hand, low E drugs, changing blood flow does not really alter the clearance that much. It's really determined by the fraction that is free or the fraction unbound, as well as the intrinsic clearance properties of the liver. Now, the enzymes in the liver that's handling the metabolism can be inhibited by other drugs or induced by some drugs. So that could definitely change the intrinsic ability of the liver to clear drug. Also, we know that polymorphisms exist in P450 enzymes that would change the ability of the enzyme to function and therefore metabolize drug. So we can have a poor metabolizer phenotype, intermediate, extensive, or ultra rapid, for example, for cytochrome P450-2D6. And we know that Q, as we saw previously, is an important factor for determining hepatic clearance. So changes in hepatic blood flow, such as we might see in chronic liver failure or in heart failure, would certainly impact the ability of the liver to clear drug. Another topic that we will be covering in this module is drug therapy in pregnant and nursing women. So we know that there's some physiologic changes in pregnancy that affect important pharmacokinetic parameters in the mother. So for example, during pregnancy, the mother has an increase in glomerular filtration rate that would change the renal clearance of drug. There's also changes in hepatic drug metabolism, and also there's an increase in total body water, which would play a role especially for drugs that have a volume of distribution in total body water. Now, once a drug is ingested by the mother, we have to be concerned with fetal drug exposure, and that is determined or influenced by several factors listed here. First, what are the physicochemical properties of the drug? Is the drug lipophilic or hydrophilic? Is it ionized at physiologic pH? What's the molecular weight of the drug? How easily does it cross the placenta? Also, there's some transporters on the placenta that can determine how easily a drug can move across the placenta from the maternal circulation to the fetal circulation. And then finally, let's consider the developmental stage of the fetus. If the drug does enter into the fetal circulation, is the fetus able to metabolize that drug? So these are all considerations regarding fetal drug exposure. Now, we also know that following birth, we have to be concerned with drug getting into breast milk and then subsequently ingested by a nursing infant. So drug partitioning into breast milk is dependent upon several factors, many of which we've already covered previously. So those include lipid solubility of the drug, the plasma protein binding of the drug, its ionization, as well as its molecular weight. Once the drug does get into breast milk, we have to consider how much gets into breast milk, how much is actually dosed to the baby during feeding. If the drug is absorbed, is the infant able to metabolize or eliminate the drug? And finally, what is the timing of the feeding relative to when the mother took the drug? So these are all factors that we have to be worried about when we look at drug exposure to a nursing infant. In this module, we're going to look at developmental and pediatric pharmacology, as well as geriatric pharmacology, which we will get to next. But we know that infants and children are not just miniature versions of adults. They have important differences in physiology that affect drug therapy. So for example, total body water is much different in a preterm infant or a full-term infant compared to an adult. So as you can see here, a premature infant has 80% of total body weight is actually body water. For a full term, it's 70%. For an adult, it's about 60%. For a geriatric patient, we see that it's about 55%. So understanding and appreciating the body water content of an infant versus an adult is very important when we look at dosing of a drug. We also know that during fetal development, as well as after birth, there's some major changes in the expression of drug metabolizing enzymes. So having a knowledge of which enzymes are present and when during development is very important when we look at this patient population. Another pharmacokinetic change that we see, or a physiologic change that we can see during development that would affect drug therapy, is the amount of gastric acid that's produced in an infant following birth versus a few weeks out. So this might affect drug dissolution and ultimately drug absorption. And then finally, renal function is generally very low when a baby is first born. However, it increases over the next week or so. So drugs that are eliminated by the kidney definitely would have to be altered. The dosing of those would have to be altered in a patient, in a pediatric patient. Now, just as we saw some physiologic changes in the early stages of life that would affect drug therapy, we have the same considerations in the geriatric population. So as we age, we know that renal function declines. So for drugs that are eliminated by the kidney, that would definitely require a dose adjustment. There's also a reduction in cardiac output. That means that blood flow is going to be reduced to eliminating organs such as the liver and the kidney. We saw previously that body fat increases as we age. So in an elderly patient, for drugs that are distributed into body fat, the volume of distribution will go up compared to an adult patient. And then finally, CYP450-3A4 activity has been shown to decrease in the elderly population. Now, 50% of drugs are metabolized by 3A4, so this is definitely an important consideration when we look at this patient population. Now, not only do we have pharmacokinetic changes that occur, we have pharmacodynamic changes that occur. So as an example, we know that elderly patients have an increased sensitivity to muscarinic receptor antagonists or anticholinergic drugs. They also have decreased sensitivity to beta-adrenergic drugs, such as beta-1 agonist or beta-antagonist. Many of you are familiar with the Beers criteria. This is a publication that is periodically updated that lists potentially inappropriate medications in this patient population. So there's many drugs, not just the ones that are listed here, many drugs that may be affected in this patient population. Now, finally, within the elderly population, they're just going to be on more medications. So there's an increased risk for drug interactions. So that would be drug-drug interactions, drug-food, or drug-disease interactions. So as you can see here, that patients who are 60 years or over in age, over a third of them are on five or more medications. Now, the last topic we will cover in the introduction here is pharmacokinetics and obesity. So we know that we are in an obesity epidemic in the United States. Every state in the United States had at least 20% of adults with obesity. Seven states had over a third of adults with obesity. Now, obesity is classified by body mass index. We use that in dosing, and we will be covering that in more detail later on in the module. So just as an overview, there are some important factors that we need to consider in obesity, some important pharmacokinetic changes. So one of those changes is a percent body fat in an obese patient. So not only are they larger, they have a higher degree of body fat. That's going to affect the volume of distribution of lipophilic drugs. Now, we can make adjustments on drug dosing based upon the patient's total body weight or actual body weight, their ideal body weight, or some type of way to adjust for body weight. And we need to consider these factors when we're dosing the drug, because without picking the appropriate weight to dose the patient, we may potentially underdose or overdose the obese patient. Not only is volume of distribution changed, also clearance is altered. So generally, clearance increases, but it's not in a linear relationship. It does not scale to body weight. Also, P450 activity may actually increase or decrease in these patients. So there's evidence that have shown that 3A4 activity decreases in the obese patient population, whereas 2E1 activity may actually increase in this population. Thank you for your time. I hope this introductory lecture gave you a good overview and hit the main points of what's going to come ahead for Module 4, the Pharmacokinetics and Drug Therapy and Special Populations module for the NIH Principles of Clinical Pharmacy course. Thank you.